time, I'd like to invite Claudia Danoff, who has been the organizer of this wonderful Ink Shabbat, to share a few words.
Shabbat Shalom. I would like to welcome everyone to our Pink Shabbat, Empowering Jewish Women, sponsored by Temple Israel, Sisterhood, and Sharsheret. So, what is Sharsheret? Sharsheret means chain in Hebrew and represents the strong, nurturing connections this organization builds to support Jewish women and their families at every stage of breast cancer and ovarian cancer. Sharsheret helps women and families connect to our community in a way that makes them feel comfortable taking into consideration their stages of life, diagnosis, or treatment, as well as their connection to Judaism. They provide educational resources and create programs for women and their families to improve their quality of life. They are the only organization that specializes in serving Jewish women with their concerns about breast cancer and ovarian cancer. Sharsheret was founded in November 2001 by the late Rochelle Shoretz when she was a 28-year-old Jewish mother 4 months after she was diagnosed with breast cancer. She realized that there was a lot of information about her disease, but she needed more. She needed help on how to explain to her children that she was going to lose her hair during chemotherapy and what would it be like to prepare for the high holidays knowing that she had a life-threatening illness. Though her grandmother died from the disease, cancer was a taboo subject in her family and she later found out in the Jewish community at large. She was finally introduced to a 31-year-old woman who was 6 months further along in her breast cancer journey. Soon, the two women were speaking every day. Realizing the positive impact of linking with a young Jewish woman like herself, someone who truly understood that what she faced, they began to create Sharsheret to help Jewish women have a place where they can turn to for support. Rochelle's legacy is her children, an incredible organization that only she could have built. Her passion and drive will forever remain in the foundation of Sharsheret. Before I turn the microphone over to Geanne to talk about her journey with breast cancer, there are a few people I would like to thank. Leah Alliers and John Patrick Alexander for the tremendous support they have given me with this event. During a time in my life where I needed to be near my mother to support her, Leah and John Patrick jumped right in and created marketing and social media communication tools and online selling page, a loot bag filled with all sorts of goodies for those that purchased the t-shirts, menu ideas for today's luncheons, and table decor. Leah and John Patrick helped me with the t-shirt sales and inventory, tracking as well as the logistics of this special event. Also, I'd like to thank Emily Rye for her amazing design of the pink Shabbat t-shirts and the article in The Heritage. Mariella Capoletti for creating some special treats and desserts for our luncheon, and Deborah Margaret for the pink olives, pink double eggs, and strawberry salad. And of course, Rabbi Neely for his total support for this event. Finally, I would like to especially thank Geanne Share for her bravery to speak to us today about her journey with breast cancer. Let us all help empower women and create a Sharsheret or chain to help support the Jewish women and their families in our community that are facing breast cancer and ovarian cancer. Geanne, the floor is
morning. Before I begin, I'd like to thank my family for their support. And here today is Adrian, Olivia, Irene, and David. I love you guys. And Ben and Angela, and any friends who are streaming, welcome to Temple Israel. And I love you too. Shabbat Shalom. Thank you, Claudia, for that informative introduction. I am a breast cancer survivor. I was diagnosed with invasive lobular carcinoma in August 2009, 9 years ago. It is a cancer that occurs in the milk-producing part of the breast, the flower-looking part inside, close to the body. It is the second most common breast cancer after invasive ductal carcinoma. Approximately 10% of all breast cancers diagnosed a year are invasive lobular, while 80% of all breast cancers diagnosed a year are invasive ductal carcinoma. Lobular carcinoma does not make a lump as a ductal carcinoma will do. It makes a film that stretches in a very sneaky way, and once it breaks out of the lobules that flower, it begins to invade the skeletal muscle and the lymph nodes that surround the breast and under the arm. Around July, a year before my diagnosis, I started to have a shooting pain under my breast that seemed to have a mind and timing of its own. I listened to my body and I began looking for a cause. I had my annual GYN appointment and he could find nothing in a physical exam. I was given my prescription for my annual mammogram where they found nothing. I was told not to worry because breast cancer doesn't hurt. Still, I had a sporadic shooting pain. I went to my general physician and he could not find anything. I couldn't pin the pain down to anything, not exercise, not sleeping position. It was consistently inconsistent. And a whole year went by. Another GYN exam that showed nothing. Another prescription for my annual mammogram. One evening, I was having an animated conversation with Adrian, my handsome husband over there, and I put my arm up in the air with expression, and as I did, I caught my reflection in the mirror. The outside of my breast pulled in when I flexed my arm, and I said, "Look at this." "Does it hurt?" Adrian asked. "No, I had never noticed it before. It was under my bra or my bathing suit." "Well," he said, "I don't care then, as long as you're healthy." I looked at my body, and I made an appointment with a plastic surgeon. This time, instead of being examined laying on my back or laying on my side, he examined me standing up. He said, "It feels like what scar tissue feels like, and when is your next mammogram?" Fortunately, it was scheduled in the next couple of days. And he said, "Well, tell them I want a picture of that. And don't worry, breast cancer doesn't hurt." When I went for my mammogram, they told me they had just changed from x-rays, changed from film x-rays to digital x-rays. But they would still have to take a few extra pictures to make sure they picked up the thickness under my breast. So 12 or 13 pictures later, they found something. It looked like a cloud or mist to me. I was given a prescription for an ultrasound. When I called to schedule the ultrasound, they wanted to schedule me in about 4 weeks. When I asked if I could get in sooner, they said, "Sure, but I have to travel 30 minutes to another hospital." 3 days later, I had my ultrasound. The ultrasound was painless. The technician came in with the radiologist. They said it was very possible that I have breast cancer. They said, "You need a biopsy quickly." I asked, They could do it now. No, they said, we used to be able to, but not anymore. I needed a surgeon, and I could get one from my doctor. I called Adrian at work. I told them what they told me, and Adrian said, I'm in the waiting room. He had a gut feeling, so he came to the hospital. I remember us standing in the parking lot and feeling how strange and how unbelievable it all seemed. My tests went to a surgeon who made room for us at the end of her non-surgery day. She told us to schedule the biopsy next week as she had surgery the next few days. I asked, can you do it now? After a few medical questions, I had my biopsy. The surgeon was 98% sure that I had breast cancer, but we really needed to wait for the lab results and the particulars. Adrian and I went to dinner. He was holding out for the 2%. Before my diagnosis, I had been led to believe that I did not have a family history of cancer, at least not one that I needed to worry about. After all, my aunt, who had breast cancer, was on my father's side. And my grandfather, father, and his two brothers, my uncle, had prostate cancer, which is a bad thing. My mother, who was diagnosed the first time with breast cancer at 84 years old, had quote-unquote old lady's cancer. No real connection. When I met my oncologist, he asked me my heritage. Well, I began. My father's parents are from Lithuania, and my mother's are, he interrupts me, I have what I need to know. He ordered genetic testing for the BRCA gene mutation. 1 in 40 men and women of Ashkenazi, Central and Eastern European and Jewish descent carries a BRCA genetic mutation that greatly increases the risk of developing breast cancer and ovarian cancer. This compares to approximately 1 in 500 men and women in the general population. That's more than 10 times more than the general population. And although these mutations are most common in Ashkenazi Jews, they have also been found in Sephardic, Spanish, Middle Eastern, Northern African Jews. Learning more about your genetic background may help identify options that can reduce your risk of developing cancer and assist in early cancer detection, which is so very important. Most breast and ovarian cancers are not hereditary. However, 5 to 10% of cancer diagnoses are estimated to occur as a result of an inherited predisposition. The inherited predisposition is caused by a gene mutation. Mutations in at least two genes, BRCA1 and BRCA2, are known to be the inherited predisposition for breast and ovarian cancer. There is also an increase of melanoma, pancreatic, and prostate cancers. Both men and women can carry a BRCA mutation and have a 50% chance, 50-50 chance, of passing that mutation on to each of their sons and daughters. It can be passed through the mother or the father. It takes only one parent, unlike Tay-Sachs disease that takes both parents. Not all children of people who have an altered gene will inherit the gene. And not all those who inherit the gene will develop breast or ovarian cancer. There is only a greater risk. So, what are some options to consider if you were to test positive with genetic testing? Increased surveillance, monitoring more closely any signs of breast and ovarian cancer. Risk reduction surgery, choosing to have at-risk tissue removed to reduce the risk of developing cancer. Chemo prevention, choosing to use natural or synthetic substances to reduce the risk of developing cancer or to reduce the risk that cancer will return. Another option, participate in a research study exploring ways to reduce cancer risk. Most individuals with breast and ovarian cancer do not have the BRCA mutation. 90 to 95% do not. And that means there's a lot more genes out there that can tell a story about cancer. A strong family history of cancer should not be ignored. That is what they are working on. I do not have the BRCA1 and BRCA2 mutation. As a cancer survivor, it helped me make decisions on my surgery and ultimately my treatment. And although it meant another biopsy, I chose to keep the healthy breast. The day of my surgery was the day of Erev Rosh Hashanah. I had a single mastectomy and the removal of 33 lymph nodes. Surgery time and hospital stay was like a drive-by. I was home in time for Adrian to make some of the first day holiday services. I was in show myself, but Kol Nidre and Yom Kippur, and it felt good to be home. My diagnosis is stage 3. That meant radiation in addition to chemotherapy. They call it the gold standard treatment. In addition, I had the right protocol or requirements to be allowed into a trial for a special drug that they knew helped many women with late stage 4 breast cancer. They figured, why wait? But not for late stage 4. Let's see what it does for people before that. It was a full year before I was finished with all my therapies. During that time, I had questions of Jewish law with regards to surgery and treatment decisions. Our rabbis, Rabbi Karas, Rabbi Rupert Jordan, and Rabbi Neely now can answer any questions with sensitivity to any unique medical situation. Studies have indicated that patients whose non-medical needs are met have better medical outcomes. During my treatment, my friend Carol Kleiner set up a schedule for friends to bring me to chemo, where Adrian met me, and then bring me home from chemo. This allowed Adrian to go to work before and after. It was incredibly helpful to us, and broke up the hours of infusion as only one person could be with me at a time. And for that, we were also grateful. My lessons learned and confirmed. Listen to your body. Look at your body. Get all the screenings possible. Don't schmy around. And put off these things. Know your family history. Knowledge is power. Exercise. Watch your weight. If you're diagnosed, keep or create a good attitude for your therapies. Advocate for yourself. Remember to ask, can we do it now? By the way, I went for my annual mammogram last month, and they have improved their digital images with 3D imagery. Fortunately or unfortunately, the test is given the same old way. I told them last time they improved their images, we found something. They said not today. They said everything is stable. Sharsheret has programs, resources, and kits that are free and confidential. They have one-on-one live support 24/7 online, genetic counseling, and peer support. They have community action, B'nai Mitzvah projects, and volunteer opportunities. They supply training of professionals, rabbis, and mikvah attendees to help them best support women and families facing breast and ovarian cancer. Programs may be accessed by phone, email, Facebook, live chat, or support partners across the United States. Together, we can ensure that no Jewish woman or family has to face breast or ovarian cancer alone. Please like Sharsheret on Facebook, follow on Twitter and Instagram, and share their posts. Tell two Thank you. And call me if you want to talk, because I'm not going anywhere.
One of the things they didn't give a class in rabbinic